So thank you all for joining us today to our first open access webinar of this academic year. I'm going to pass it over to Tim Monteith. He's going to be our host today. He's a researcher on the CIVICA project at the London School of Economics.
Thank you very much. And thank you to everyone for joining us today. The format for the talk today is both Patrick and Francis are going to talk for about 10 to 15 minutes each on the topic, and then we're going to have 30 minutes for questions at the end. So if you have any questions you'd like to ask, please just type them in a chat box and I'll read them out to Patrick and Francis, and hopefully we can have a really fruitful discussion. They both have a wealth of knowledge, and I'm sure there'll be lots of questions to ask. Before we get started, I'd just like to flag up two more CIVICA webinars that are coming up. On the 27th of September, we have a talk on pre-registration in the social sciences with Dr. Lou Safra. And on the 13th of October, we have another talk on open access publishing, what authors need to know, with Frances Pinter again and her colleague, Emily Pazansky. And I believe my colleague Kunda is going to be posting links in the chat for people to sign up to those talks if they'd like to. So our two speakers today are Francis Pinter and Patrick Dunleavy. Francis is the executive chair of the Central European University Press. She received her PhD from the London School of Economics and is also currently a visiting fellow at the LSE. She has a wealth of experience in the publishing industry, including founding her own press, Francis Pinter Publishing, being the founding publisher at Bloomsbury Academic, and with multiple and extensive work with the Open Society Initiative. Patrick Dunleavy is an emeritus professor at the LSE and is editor-in-chief at the LSE Press. He's authored numerous books, most recently including Maximizing the Impacts of Academic Research, and for any PhD students in the audience, Authoring a PhD, which is a superb book, which I would highly recommend to anyone that is trying to write a thesis at the moment. So with those introductions done, I'd like to pass over to Francis to start her section of the talk.
Thank you very much, Tim. If you'd like to help me with my slides, thank you very much. We're going to be looking at how the open access landscape has changed and academic publishing has changed, and prepare you for the changes that are still to come. Next slide, please. What we're going to do is see what it is that you need to know about, what the policy changes are at the highest levels and how that impacts on you. I'll be going over some of the open access terminology and some of the new business models and what that means for you. Next, Tim. So this is my little image for how the publishing industry looks to us as publishers and to you as potential authors. Open access policies are in play. They are being developed as we speak. Funding for open access is incredibly chaotic, and I'll be talking about that. Various business models are being developed and trialed and put into place. Libraries play a key role in all of this because they are the bridge from publishers to readers in the academic world, but of course there's a broader world beyond that. New content, new services are being developed in the digital realm, which is also a development that we've had to deal with over the last 20 years. And authors and readers are in the middle of all of this with then demands for metrics to see how we're doing in this strange new world of both digital and open access. And all the infrastructures that need to be behind the scenes are being worked on now. So the next slide, please. And in the middle of all of this comes open science, which is something that is a bit newer than the original open access movement itself. But it's a it's increasingly important for those who are applying for grants. And the idea is that open science should be open from the very beginning of a project, from the hypothesis to the data collection, to the processing, the storage of that data and how that is used, and long-term preservation. And of course, publishing must be open access so that it can be reused. And here we're talking about science in the continental way. Science refers to all disciplines, whereas in the UK and in America, tends to be restricted more to the world of the humanities and the STEM subjects, the science, technology, engineering, mathematics. But here it's for everything, and you will need to look at the fine print in your grant applications to see how you meet those criteria that are being set. Next slide, please. But I do want to underscore that policies are not mandates. So policies come first, then come the mandates, which are decrees from the funding bodies. And then comes the question of money, and they don't always follow on. And so what has happened in the publishing world is that we've been kind of left on our own to figure out what to do. And this is quite interesting, and I will be talking a lot about this in a few slides onwards. So bear in mind, it's a process. And research funders have begun to seriously mandate going open access in Europe, in the UK, and in the United States. Next, please. You may hear from time to time something called Plan S. This is a group of national funders at the international level, various charitable funders, very large ones, and even larger at the EU level and the European Research Council, which is responsible for billions and billions of euros of research money. These bodies have all now mandated. And it was originally the case that journals were mandated to go open access, and now we're in the middle of the process of mandating open access for books, and the deadline differs in different countries and so on, but it's around 2024, which is just around the corner. So next slide, please. And I just wanted to make a mention of something that's happened recently, and this will make a little more sense when I've gone through the rest of the slides, but it demonstrates we're on a journey. In 2013, the White House mandated that all federal agencies with funding of over 100 million for research had to make their outputs open access, but they were given a bit of leeway. There was a 12-month grace period after publication. Now, just a few weeks ago, a new mandate has come down, updating the old one, and there's no embargo allowed. The outputs have to go open access immediately, and it refers to all of the federal agencies, which it includes many more in the social sciences and humanities. So this is beginning to take hold in our subjects that we're concerned about here. So next slide, please. Now, something you will be hearing a lot about on your journey to being published. Do you want green, gold, or diamond? And the publishing industries and the policymakers and the academics who are interested in this kind of thing argue endlessly over which is the better route to open access. They all get you there, but it is a question of money and where you find that money. So next slide. The I am going to spend a little time here now on the differences between green, gold, and diamond for journals, and we'll also get to books. Green is, you can put your article, usually, and this is a bit nebulous, prior to copy editing and all the additional elements that a publisher puts into it, into any open access public repository. Your university will have one, and there may be an embargo set, but there are no charges to this. The gold open access is different because effectively the gold route is paying the publisher for the publishing services that the publisher provides and costs the publisher money to make available. And these costs are referred to as an article processing charge. The diamond open access is a bit newer, and here there are publishing operations that are funded not through article processing charges, but through support from the parent institution or a learned society or somewhere where the money can be found to keep the journal going sustainable over the years. Next slide, please. And if all of that seemed complicated, it gets even worse with books. And I would suggest that you do a little bit of reading on this for both the journals and books. But here, what you can do with a book to go green, I put it into a repository, is much more limited at the moment. It tends to be that the publisher allows one chapter that can be put into a repository. And now most publishers are offering a gold route. If you can find anything from here, £5,000 to £15,000, and it's not that dissimilar in euros, a little bit more. You will be able to have your book published as open access. Next slide, please. So what is an APC? It is this payment. It's an article processing charge for the publishing process paid up front in exchange for open access. And the debates around it are who pays, what business model, does it really cover all the publishing costs? Is it really just a way of maximizing the profits for the big companies? And why do the APCs cost vary so much? We don't have time to go into that, but if you're interested, raise it question time. Next slide, please. What's a book processing charge? Well, it's similar because it pays for a book and it has some of the same issues around it. But with books, there's also the opportunity to sell in other formats, particularly print, where a reader or library wants a printed copy. Most publishers will make those printed copies available for sale. Quite right, because there's a cost to printing them, and it helps contribute to the cost of the project, the publication itself. Next slide, please. And then, just to make things even more confusing, but really, I think, very important, particularly now that some of the APC, BPC models have settled down, is that people have understood that these models all require funding to travel with the individual writer, author, academic. And that creates inequality. What about, particularly in the social science and especially in the humanities, when so much is written that is not funded by research funding, that where you can carve out a little money for an APC or a BPC, what do you do about getting the funding for open access? There aren't very many diamond journals around. It is very new. What are your options? Patrick will talk a bit more about that. But it's generally acknowledged that we need non-author-facing charges. That's how it's referred to. And we're getting there. There are a number of initiatives, but we don't have time to go over that now. Next slide, please. So I thought it might be helpful to introduce the concept of copyright and licensing in the middle of all of this. We moved away from business models and to what are your rights as the copyright holder? It is simply the right to copy, and it is your right if you are the creator of the content. Historically, journals, journal publishers used to insist on copyright transfer, that would be done by contract, but this is no longer favored as a way of moving ahead, and especially not in open access. So now mostly authors keep their copyright. Books, traditionally, it was the case that authors kept their copyright, so there was no need to change. And licensing, what is licensing? Well, it's the legal language used to describe the terms under which people are allowed to use the copyrighted material. So how do you license open access material? I mean, it's free on the web, but it's important to license. And we're gonna look at that right now. Tim, next. You will have seen that little black circle with two C's on it. Many, many items. Billions of them, whether they're licensing that was developed some 20 years ago to ensure that it would be possible to have a some rights reserved policy. And what was really important to the developers of this license was that attribution should be a critical factor in all of this. And so you as a copyright holder can, in putting your content up online for free, license it with a CC BY license, which means you can do anything you like, but you have to attribute it to me, the author. Now, there are a number of other licenses that gradually limit the range of things that can be done or allowed to be done online. And these are the ones that are most important to you are the third one down, attribution, no derivatives. For instance, a derivative would be a translation. You want to control the quality of the translation. So it doesn't mean nobody can translate it. It just means they have to come back to you as the copyright holder to make sure you're happy. You may want to be paid for the translation. That's fine, but it means that control is up to you. Then there's the attribution non-commercial license, which says anybody can do whatever they like, except make money. They cannot sell it. They're not allowed to sell it. This is particularly important for books because publishers want to control the print sales of books that are licensed with a Creative Commons license online, so that they can generate that extra revenue. And that's important to make the projects viable. And also, it's important to protect the public from people who are otherwise able to generate a print copy and sell it for more than what the publisher is charging. So good reasons for the NC license. And then you can mix and match. But let's go on to the next slide. So finally, this is a little bit of a summary of the things that you should be thinking about when you are thinking about where and with whom you should be publishing. If you're going down the APCPC route, check on fees, because they do vary. If you are worrying about the licensing, make sure you understand the Creative Commons licensing and which version you can put online and which version you can't put online without the agreement of the publisher, etc. What kind of repository type are you putting your content in? That matters because not all repositories are as good as we would like to see them all be. And what embargoes, is there any time limit on things that you can do with your content? Just be sure you understand everything that is expected of you. And generally, publishers have got this information on their websites. Next slide, Tim. So here's my wish for the future in the next few years. This is taking all those pieces that were all over the place in the beginning. And I do feel confident that with the goodwill of the academic community, with the library community, with the publishing community and the funders, that we are getting all these pieces in place. And the situation that we're in today will seem like ancient history within 5 to 10 years. That's my bet. Meanwhile, my final slide, Tim, the future. You have to be aware of the fact that there's no single source of funding that will cover all publications. So you really need to do your research on this. There's no single publishing model that will cover everything. There never was in the old world, and then it never will be in this new world. The infrastructure, by that, the whole world of library supply and discovery and accessibility, we're working on it. We're working on it hard, and a lot of money is being poured into developments at the moment, but it's not there yet. So if you want to be publishing something now, or in the next year or two, three, you're going to be publishing in the midst of actually a revolution, and actually the best, most exciting revolution that we have seen in scholarly communication and the communication of scholarly material outside the scholarly world. So it's tough. You're going to have to devote a lot of time to it, but it really is very, very promising. So now I'm going to hand over to Patrick. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Frances. That's wonderful. And Frances is just a wonderfully authoritative voice on academic publishing in all its aspects. So what I'm going to try and do here is just take the information that she's given you and try and meld it a bit towards the issue of how do I decide between closed paywall type publishing or open access publishing? And of course, where do I do open access publishing? How much does it cost? And so on. And I'm going to sort of start off with discussing this in a general way, but partly orientated towards journals, and then say a little bit more specifically about open access publishing of books compared with conventional models. So if we move on, Tim, basically publishing is very important for academic careers. We all know that. It always has been, always will be. But alongside the revolution in publishing itself that Frances has so brilliantly described, there is also a huge sea change going on in the way in which academic careers are structured and what kind of things matter for academic advancement and for career building. And essentially, we're moving from an old legacy way of working, which was very orientated towards elite institutions and elite publications, which was very much about building a CV. It didn't really matter if anybody read any of the stuff on the CV, but what you wanted was to have lots of stuff on your CV. And you can see that today still, that legacy, when people apply for jobs and they have the CV with lots of things listed and no URL links for me to look at, you know, what exactly it was that they wrote. So it's a very deeply rooted kind of, let's just build a CV. It doesn't matter if anybody reads it or how much use is made of it. So that's the old legacy way. And the new way, which has been resisted by people on the left because it's seen as a sort of neoliberal conspiracy, and people on the right because they're very conservative and want to stick with everything traditional, is a sort of digital era way where, you know, how far you advance in academia is going to depend on how much your work is influential and how much your work is actually being used. So, you know, you can have a great CV of unreadable stuff, but if nobody reads it or cites it, you're not going to do as well as if you did more of an effort to make sure that it got out there. So I'm just going to run through a couple of things about these two different ways of doing it. The legacy way of doing it is to spend a lot of time, you know, doing your PhD, or if you're in a sort of papers model PhD thing, just working on one or two papers. In LSE economics, for example, there's a thing called the job market paper, and people spend years of their life trying to get a job market paper finished and then trying to get it into one, you know, prestige journal. And the process can take, you know, 3 to 5 years. And of course, you'll get a lot of advice from traditional old-fashioned academics who are basing their views on what happened to them 20 years ago, where they say, oh, you must only ever send your article or your book to, the article can only go to high-prestige journals, or the book should only go to publishers with legacy operations and a lot of paywall pricing. Now, things have changed a little bit in countries where governments haven't negotiated with the big publishers. So some top journals and some publishers will do open access, either at very high prices. So, you know, Nature, for example, will publish your piece open access for £9,500 for a short article. In the social sciences, it's quite common to see, you know, £1,500 to £3,000, well, €3,000 kind of charges. But some people may get to do open access because of wider agreements between governments and funding coalitions and the publishers. But usually these people are just the regular kosher academics who've got tenure track jobs, and it's very much more tricky and difficult to assess what happens with people who are kind of in the academic precariat now, which in most countries will be, you know, the first 5 years of your career, or PhDs or postdocs and so on. So there's a huge bunch of people for whom these agreements may or may not work. And then, of course, if you, sorry, Tim, just one last. The old legacy way of doing it is, if you can't get something into a high prestige journal or a high prestige publisher, then you go down a hierarchy of progressively less good ones, which in terms of charges and paywall charges for open access may decline a bit, but also, of course, you're taking a visibility hit when you do that in the legacy conception. So now we can move on, Tim. What are the problems with the legacy way of doing it, and why is it dying out despite all the lamenting and by conservatives and suspicion by, you know, people on the left that this is a neoliberal plot afoot? Well, basically, there are very high opportunity costs. It's an incredibly stressful, erratic, and problematic way of working, unless you happen to be lucky enough to be at a very elite institution. And in particular, one thing that's very important for early career people to think about is that time spent revising articles for demanding journal readers or reviewers, or for going through multiple submissions to a sort of sequence of journals, this is all very time-consuming. Journals take 3 to 6 months to decide. You can't send it to more than one journal at once. It all slows down the tempo of publications. And even for full-time academics who are very good at this, you know, the published articles in high-quality journals, high-prestige journals, tend to be sort of tombstones of documenting research that was done three years ago. And similarly, if you're thinking about publishing a whole doctorate, if you're in one of the book-using disciplines, you humanities and many qualitative social sciences, then time spent on publishing a doctorate with a lot of changes for a demanding publisher can really erode your scarce postdoc periods. I'm constantly amazed at seeing US graduates who've taken, you know, 5 years after finishing to get their doctorate out. And of course, the other big thing about the legacy way of doing things is you publish a book paywall and it becomes almost invisible. You'll be lucky if you sell a monograph to more than 300 readers. Paywall articles are a bit better, but paywall chapters in books also are pretty much a complete waste of time. You might as well dig a hole in the ground, said an Oxford psychologist recently about that, and bury your chapter in it in terms of paywall chapters. And then the final thing to bear in mind is to be cited at all in the future, or to be used for teaching even, because everything in teaching is digital now, your outputs must be digital. So paper-only publication, which is still widespread for books and edited books, is just hopeless. Don't even think about doing anything in a paper-only way, because you're completely wasting your time if you did that. Let's move on to the new way, which is more optimistic. So how does publishing affect careers here? Well, what matters is how your work is used. And we can tell how your work is used pretty well immediately by citations. Okay, they take a long time to happen. But then downloads, online reads, and what are called alt metrics, which are alternative metrics. So what you want to do in this way of doing things is to publish your articles or books wherever they can best build your citations, your H score, and the extent to which your work is being used. Now, in the old days, that meant you had to send them to elite publications because most citations were from elite publications. But the digital decompression of information in the current era means that good research is findable via search engines wherever it's published, so long as it's in a reasonably reputable journal or publisher. It's no more findable in a legacy prestige outlet via Google Scholar than in a medium-sized range journal or a new journal. And the key thing that's happened in publishing is that the proportion of all citations to outputs in the top 10 journal in each field has fallen radically in social science. It was always pretty low in social science. It's fallen even more, and it's changed particularly dramatic in some fields. So let's just look at that on the next slide, Tim. And this was work done by the guy who set up Google Scholar, who's a genius. And he and his team looked at literally hundreds of thousands of articles across all the disciplines. And they on the left-hand side of the picture, that you can see the 1995 picture of what proportion of articles of citations were to non-top 10 journals. And back in 1995, that proportion was 27%. In other words, 63%. 73% was going to the top 10 journals and only 27% was going to the non-top 10. Well, what's happened since? The research only carries us up to 2013, but you can see that the proportion of citations to non-top 10 journals increased dramatically, more than basically doubled really in the period. The change was less in social science than some other areas, because social science already had citations to a lot more journals than other fields. But you can see that in things like business and economics, there's been a massive change, and computer science and so forth. Just to simplify that picture a little, in the next slide, you can see the proportion of Google Scholar citations outside the top 10 journals in 1995 at the bottom, and in 2013 at the top. And you can, they're slightly scaled differently, but you can see that the change has been particularly good in some disciplines like computer science, and slower in other things like chemical material science. And social science is pretty much on this trend, which tends to slow off as you get to higher levels. Okay, so what does that mean, Tim? Well, what it means is that there's a wholly different way of disseminating awareness about your work now. And if you really want to read up on this, then I recommend my book on maximizing the impacts of academic research, which there's a reference to at the end with Jane Tinkler. But essentially, social media and digital communications are now key for disseminating awareness of your work. And especially are salient are linkages that go, you tweet, you then, the tweet leads to blogs, the blogs leads to an open access text, ideally gold open access from the outset. Green open access, is it worth bothering almost? I think we should be really trying to focus on everything being, you know, immediate open access. And then authors themselves have to be active in online dissemination, cast aside the sort of academic over-diffidence of previous eras. And just to finally add here that a good, well-promoted open access chapter in an edited book, especially one that's been through peer review and has good editors, can be absolutely just as useful for teaching use and absolutely just as much cited as journal articles now. So that's a complete change. So long as the chapter is open access, you know, you can promote it yourself and get it widely. Now, I've taken too long going through this thing, but let me just...
Patrick, you're on mute.
Sorry, can we move on, Tim? Sorry, I've... Well, basically, just to think about your access, your options for book publishing, and really you've got, you know, still a predominance of paywall publishing in this area, and by 2024, certainly in the UK, if your book is going to be used by your university to get funding, then it has to be open access, and that applies even to monographs. So really, you've got three options. I won't go through them in detail. I'll just say one quick word about them. So moving on, Tim. You've still got the prestige legacy university presses, which are very important in some disciplines still, and with some kinds of academics. And these are the kind of people who used to say, oh, this is published by Oxford University Press, must be good. But nowadays, more and more people are being very skeptical about that. Must be good. You know, the question is, has anybody read it? Has anybody used it? Is it any good for anything that you can do? You can do this still if you're a full academic, full-time academic. Paywall monographs are very expensive, around about $12,000 with prestige presses. They don't get promoted very much. Usually they don't sell very much. Unless they make it into ebook packages, they will not be used for teaching either. So just be very careful about the previous unthinking, oh, it pays to get it into a legacy university press view. Secondly, Tim, you can go to a kind of medium reputation commercial press outlet. And these people tend to be a little bit quicker. The transaction costs of dealing with them tend to be a bit less, and they can look reasonable on your CV. But they're still going to charge you around about $10,000. They'll be ruthless in promoting your book for 1 year and then forgetting about it and promoting next year's books. That's just the way publishers are. You'll get very few paywall sales. And some of these publishers still don't have ebook packages and are not plugged into the sort of library consortia world, especially amongst European publishers, smaller European publishers. Final option is to use an open access university press. Well, because it's a university press, you'll get a better review process that can add value. You probably will get a good, depends what the university is, but you'll get sort of kudos from publishing with the university press in academic circles. Can be very quick because especially if they're not trying to do legacy print and all that kind of stuff, it's possible to produce a book in 4 or 5 months from a really good manuscript. Open access, of course, is going to look good on your CV. It's going to maximize possible readership and thus maximize citations. And born digital outputs, especially chapters in books, for example, fit easily into teaching and wider library catalogs. And you'll get lots of usage indicators from the publisher and lots of altmetric measures. So you know who's using your book and how they're doing. The disadvantage is there's still a cost involved in doing this. It's a lower cost with open access press. For example, UCL Press is quoting around about £5,000 for a 70,000 word book. Some presses will do more varied kind of things. So LSE Press, for example, we have a needs blind policy. If we see, if we're given a book that we think is good and it's really very impossible for the author to cover the costs, we would normally look to see what we could do to do that. So what are the disadvantages? Well, you still have some prejudices amongst old guard academics against open access publishers. I haven't the least idea why. Plus, you need to be active in promoting your own work, not diffident. So that's really the key difference. I think we can skip the next slide and go straight to the thank you and question time, Tim.
Yes, thank you very much, Patrick and Francis. It's been a really insightful set of talks. I'd just like to encourage everyone who's been listening to write up questions they may have in the chat box for either Patrick or Francis or addressed to both of them. Just while people are maybe thinking of some questions or writing them down, I'll start us off with one. Patrick, you mentioned that open access publishing is much better for metrics in terms of citations, or metrics in terms of impact and dissemination. But thinking specifically from the author's perspective, how much should metrics be in the forefront of their mind when they're thinking about publication venues and what's best for them?
Well, I'm kind of a bit of a metrics enthusiast, so I'm a little bit out at one pole. And there are some people, you know, conservative folk who don't like metrics because they think they don't really capture academic quality. And similarly, some people on the left who think metrics are part of a giant conspiracy that we've somehow erected in academia in order to help late stage capitalism. But both of these points of view have some merit. I mean, we certainly don't want people to be obsessed by metrics. But and it's also very important to recognize that a lot of metrics are, you know, very skewed in various kinds of ways. So if you're in a large country and you're publishing in a large language group, you'll get more citations than if you're in a small country and a small language group. Similarly, depending on where you are in the academic discipline, the scope of what you can be cited for, of course, varies. But there's a long discussion in my book about how that's operating now, and universities have got very much more skill now in understanding what is a good performance in different fields and different disciplines. So, for example, STEM work tends to be, STEM disciplines work tends to be cited a lot more. Social sciences is cited somewhat less. Humanities, at the moment, has tended to be cited quite poorly. So there's different sort of field-specific contexts for looking at your metrics. But then the departments or the university working will know how to assess all of that. Of course, the other thing about metrics is that they are skewed in various ways. They discriminate. Citations are great for people like me who've been working away for 40 years in the field. Gradually, you get more and more citations and everybody says, oh, you're very successful. Meanwhile, if you're an early career person, of course, it takes you months or years even to get your first few citations. So that's very, very much a problem. But, there are measures that allow for that, such as age-weighted citation indicators. Plus, alt metrics now are much quicker. So how many people have viewed your book, how many, or your chapter or your article, how many people have downloaded it. In many open access platforms like PLOS One in the STEM sciences or Open Research Europe in all the disciplines for people who've got Horizon grants, you get reader reactions and evaluations and commentary and so on. So I think there's a much faster, quicker, more dynamic process. And also if you tweet and use blogs, you'll find that you can reach people and people will say things to you that will save you months of time. They'll say, why don't you look at this? I saw a data set that looked like that. There's a variable in this obscure data set that you've never heard of. All of that can happen if you're digital and if you're digitally orientated. And if you're not digital and you're just sitting in your own university, you're going to be just years behind the curve of where the debate is and where the research is. That's my view. So I think it's worth taking metrics and outreach and dissemination by the author themselves. That's very, very important. I don't know if Francis would agree.
Yeah, sort of. But can I add something to this? There's a quotation that I just love called, which says, not everything that can be counted counts, and not everything that counts can be counted. And looking at the different patterns of citation for books and journals, it's really interesting, particularly in the social sciences, because you see a leap in activity just when a book is published. Then there's 2 or 3 years before the reviews in the established journals come out. And then it's about 5 years before a book gets referenced in another book that somebody has written, which has been published then. So, my worry at the moment is that really, it's a very primitive look at the metrics, particularly comparing books with journal articles, will be misinterpreted. The value of social sciences and humanities, the value is seen further down the line than in the STEM subjects. And also the other side is that universities are reevaluating whether or not they should be putting so much emphasis on the traditional metrics, such as the Web of Science and Scopus. And I think the University of Leiden has just abandoned using those metrics for purposes of evaluation and promotion. And I suspect others will follow suit.
Yes, I'm against using metrics for formalized career assessment, but my point would be that actually informally your position in disciplines now is going to be influenced by metrics, and if you can't show anybody's read your work even or downloaded it or used it in teaching then it's not really going to be feasible for you to expand beyond perhaps your home university, that other people will find it very hard. Of course, there are various agreements that are in place, including the San Francisco Declaration, the Leiden Concordat on making sure that metrics are part of a balanced overall assessment of somebody's career. And that's very important too.
And I think the application of things like altmetrics is becoming much easier now that one of the things that happened as a result of the COVID pandemic was that publishers rushed to digitize their backlist, books already published, which had been moving along, but accelerated in pace dramatically. And so now at least books are, no new books are coming out just in paper, except perhaps from some obscure publisher, because it just has to be in digital form.
I got one from a publisher in Belgium the other day.
Well, I think these are few and far between the publishers that do that. And just looking at the open access stats, there are various statistics on this, but now in the aggregate, about 50% of all journal articles from those journals that are measured, which is all of the important ones and many, many of the less important ones, about 50% are open access. With books, it's about 10%. That's this lag because it's just taking longer to mandate the books and getting the business models up and running. So I'm a bit more positive about this all because I see the progress that's being made behind the scenes, but I'm sure there are the exceptions that prove the rule.
I just want to hop in with another quick question there following Patrick's comment about the book from the Belgian publisher. Francis, you have a wealth of experience publishing or being involved with publishers across Europe. I was just wondering if you could say a little bit about how much what we've talked about today and the advice that you've given may apply to publishers in different languages on the continent or within different publishing traditions.
Yes, I mean, it's really important, and it speaks to the book that Patrick received from a Belgian publisher. The tradition of supporting print publication is much stronger on the continent. Most countries have, the central governments, the central pots of money have been available for printing the monographs of their scholars, whether these are adaptations of PhDs or further down the line, there has been that money to support and subsidize the publication process. Now, sadly, historically, this has led to a lot of authors having piles of books that were paid for in their offices, and they sit there not doing anything apart from gathering dust. But the good thing about it is that having had that tradition, it was easier to flip to supporting digital output. Support in the UK or the US for this kind of thing generally was far less. And so the money that is needed now to support open access has to come via different routes and different pots of money. So that's sort of generally across the board. Now, you also asked about languages, and of course, it is much harder to find the funding, but smaller languages have got more funding to support those languages precisely because they are small. And so it kind of depends on the country.
Thank you very much. And finally, we just have a question from Zia Udin in the chat, who loves to read hard copies of books and articles online, and was just wondering if you have any research on reader choice in terms of different age groups or different readerships in terms of choosing open access publishing.
On the readership, there is, but I don't have it at hand. I think everybody wants to be sure that the online book is also available in print. And that's not difficult to do, and publishers are happy to do it. They have to incorporate this into their workflow. It needs to be set up. But there is something called print on demand, which allows them to print a single copy or two or three or five at a price that, at a cost, which enables them to sell it at a reasonable price. And that's, again, that's technology coming into its own to help support what we all want to take forward from the old world, which is the availability of the printed book. Journals, they went digital a long time ago, and there's far less demand for the printed copy. You just print out an article that you want. And I think that kind of answers the second part of that sentence, unless you're asking a completely different question, but I hope I've covered it.
I think it's worth mentioning in the context of academic books that, there's been some discussion in sort of general publishing that the shift to ebooks was, very much touted. People expected to see a bigger transition than actually happened, and publishers have responded by lowering the costs of hard copy books in non-academic markets. And so, to some extent, hard copy reading has had a bit of a bounce back, and including a bit of a bounce back amongst particularly younger readers. But in academia, we're in a different world. People are using libraries fully digitally now. And one of the huge problems that people have, if you ask them about ebooks, is that they think about these sort of various fake kind of ebook ways of reading that you can get from some libraries. Now, I know this is true of my own library of LSE. I'm constantly coming up against books which have been allegedly made available digitally, but you can only download them for a day, or you can only download one chapter or two chapters, or you can only read, so you have to try and read them online. You can't copy, you can't do any of the things you'd normally do with a book. So there's lots of fake ebooks which are fake digitally available. And the thing I'd like to stress is, if you go with an open access publisher, you're going to get, no fuss, instant download. You get the whole book. It's on a CC BY license of some kind, of the kind that Francis described. And that's what you really want. So anything less than that is not really digital publication. It's pseudo digital publication. And that's also why some people have been a bit in academia, because of these pseudo publication limits. They've been a bit anti ebook in some cases. The other thing to think about is, we're in the very early days of developing ebooks. So, the printed hard copy book has been around for thousands of years. People have worked away on this aspect and that aspect of printing the paper, the presentation, the whole way in which you construct it. Also, we have centuries of knowledge of how to use hard copy books. So we're just at the early stages of changing that for ebooks. Ebooks have only just started. Proper ebooks will evolve very rapidly in the next 10 years. Particularly to include video, photographs, and other elements that ordinary hard copy books can't do. And certainly at LSE Press, we're constantly held back by having to produce a print copy or a surrogate for some feature that we can give you in the hard copy, in the digital copy. That's the big difference, I think. Mm. I don't know if you want to comment on pseudo ebooks or pseudo digital access.
No, well, perhaps this is a good place to wrap up our discussion. I think, yeah, it's been a really fantastic to see the overviews that you've given. I think a really good discussion of some of the aspects of open access publishing. And I'd like to thank you both for speaking today and for everyone that's attended.
Thank you.
Tim, do you want to show my slide of last resources, just in case anybody's interested? A sort of a parting shot.
Here we go. These are the final resources.
Thank you, everyone. And just as a reminder, this recording will be available online shortly if you want to watch it again. And yes, definitely take advantage of all these resources. Thank you to all of our participants today. And one last reminder, we will be having another open science event on pre-registration on September 27th. And there will be a further open access publishing event on the 13th of October. And you can find information about that shortly.